What my stats don't tell you is that I spent my childhood in the great state of Alabama, so my residence is Missouri, but my heart is always in Dixie. Well, can I ask my friends up in the sound booth to bring me down a little bit, because I've got an echo, and that's perfect. Okay, so I found out several months ago about the opportunity to come and share with your graduating class. And I just have to tell you, I only had a snapshot. Maybe we had 2 hours last night, but I learned so much about what this community, the church and the school, has to offer. And I was just sitting here as I got the opportunity to experience the time in music worship, and I thought to the passage in 1 Kings when the Queen of Sheba came to visit Solomon. Now, I'm no queen, okay, so we'll settle that one. But when the Queen of Sheba comes to visit Solomon, she says, you know, I heard about you, but until I got here, the half had not been told. And I must tell you that my wife and I, I tuned in, I shared with the students yesterday, I am not that creepy guy, but I need to find some stuff out. So I went online and started looking at websites and videos and saw one of your services, and I said, look at this. Look at what's happening here. And I'm watching Pastor Brent as he's leading the choir. And tell me your first name.
Gerard,
who's got the matching tie and Vans on today. I don't know if you noticed that. But I'm watching them maneuver around, and I thought, I would just like to go. But here I am, and I have hopefully your attention for the next few minutes. What a blessing to be in a body of believers where in a moment of time each week you have the opportunity to Sabbath. And something was mentioned, and I believe Gerard said it, that we, in a moment, our time of worship is preparing us. We Sabbath into the next week. We don't rest from what we just did. It prepares us for what's coming up ahead. For you graduates, I'm always excited. You know what's interesting is that graduation is a finish. It's a finish. We finish this. But we have the ceremony known as commencement, which means start. And so you have these two colliding, if you will, but really it's joining, like the linking of railway cars. And you finish something. Life is always about graduation and commencement. Graduation, commencement. We're always moving. Why? Because God has given each one of us a capacity. And we don't know the depth of it. But it's our responsibility to do what is in our hand, the best of what we have. Find out what your best is. This is what I'm drilling down with my students at Evangel. And I will tell you that our partnership with Bethesda, I'm grateful for what we have been able to do. I'm grateful for what Bethesda does for Evangel in providing us an opportunity to partner in a way where we can offer dual credit. And our hope is that many of you will find a way to Evangel and come be with me, because people who go to church like this need to be at Evangel to continue to strengthen us. So that's my shameless plug. I believe in Christian education because of these things. Our faith in Christ gives us eternity. That's a guarantee. That's a promise. That is a promise. Our education gives us credibility on this side, if we are stewards of it. But when we combine our faith and our education, now we're cooking with gas. Because now we have supernatural influence in situations we would never had imagined. And so today, as we spend just some time, I just want to share with you a few things. I'm a lover of the Word of God. I was raised on Bible stories. Pastor mentioned my father. I don't know if anybody does something for 40 years anymore. I once asked my dad one time, we were working on a project in my house, and I said, Dad, did you really think you would last that long? He says, no. He said, I thought I'd last for 8 years, and then we'd go back and pastor back in Alabama. And they just kept coming up with projects, and he just kept staying with it, and just like that, 40 years went by, and it's amazing to think about that and all that has happened as a result of the team that he was a part of. And I am a fortunate son because I have the opportunity to continue and to be a part of something that I truly believe in, and that is the ability of meshing our faith with our education and then watching God move people across this planet in places of influence. So as a lover of the Bible, it started with Bible stories. My parents would read to my brothers and me. I have two brothers. And we would read these Bible stories. But as I matured, this is one of the things that I learned. Because people are concerned about, am I doing what God wants me to do? Am I actually fulfilling what his plan is? But what we miss is sometimes people want to know, but they don't want to read this. Now, I know that there are a variety of modalities for finding the Word of God. I'm a huge fan of YouVersion because there's tons of different plans that you can get involved in. I just happen to read the Bible through every year. Don't be impressed. If you read a little bit every day, you can do that. But I just started reading over 30 years ago. Just every year I would read through the Bible. And you know what's amazing? Is that passage in Hebrews that says that the Word of God is alive. It's alive and it cuts to the very core of our being. And it discerns our hearts. And if you read it enough, you begin to memorize phrases, words, scriptures. And God brings to your attention by the power of his Holy Spirit truth. And that aligns with what his will is. And oftentimes he will say, just do what you're doing, but do your very best. As worship, and then watch what happens. And it's all throughout the scriptures. So as I watch the passages in the scriptures, it brings me to one of my favorite stories is found in John chapter 4. And it's about the encounter that a person has with Christ, and it's fully transferable into our lives today. And I just want to share with you a little bit about that story. Now, I know that John chapter 3 gets all the attention. We know that because we've watched enough football. There's always somebody behind the goalpost with John 3:16, right? Or they've got it on their eye black. Now, okay, let me just relate to you a little bit. I grew up a Cowboys fan. So I knew that would get some love there. But I'm a Roger Staubach, Drew Pearson, Tony Dorsett Cowboys fan, okay? Their posters were, there we go, I see a hand. So I had their posters in my room, and in my high school locker, I had a picture of Drew Pearson. He's one person I've never met that I hope one day I do. But I patterned everything about him, and I love that experience as a kid growing up, being a fan of that, and the stories that I would read. But in the Word of God, there are great stories of great heroes, and some of them are people that we will never, ever know their names. And so I want to show you something that just means so much to me, that as I've read it, and this hopefully will be an encouragement to you, that as you read the Word of God over and over again, he will begin to show you deeper things. And as I read this passage, I hope that it will be this mean the same to you. So let's take a look. The first thing I want to show you is in the beginning. So John chapter 1 begins with this passage that opens up about what it is. So he says this. He says, in the beginning, the Word already existed. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now the Word, we know, or if you've read it enough, the Word means Christ. But it also has been declared as the divine expression of God. The divine expression of God was in existence. It was there in the beginning, and God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and darkness can never extinguish it. Now, this is one of the things. So each of us have been, okay, as a classroom teacher, I have two groups of people that come in my classroom. There are extroverts and there are introverts. And there might be some that are in between that can work between the two cohorts. Now, some of you are extroverts. Like there are people in this room who could walk right up here right now and speak. But I bet I can find in this room, just by looking across this crowd, that there's some people who would be absolutely terrified to come up here. And I'm going to find you because I'm going to bring you up here. Okay. I'm just kidding. Because I love to do that. And in my classroom, I find those people in both cases. But here's the deal. Everyone influences the room. Everyone influences the room, no matter how you present yourself. Now think about this. When Jesus walked into a room, there was light. And it wasn't just, and it's not a blinding light where people run. It was a light that draws people in. And we know that because it says in the book of Luke, it talks about how the writer speaks about how taxpayers and notorious sinners. Now, you just use your imagination. But all of these individuals, they were drawn. They wanted to sit with him. They would sit and listen to him. And that's amazing to me. But that's the light. Why? Because the light, it says in that passage, the light extinguishes the darkness. That's so powerful. And he came to the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. And he came into his own people, and even they rejected him. But to all who believed in him and accepted him, he gave the rights to become children of God. That is so powerful. That everywhere Jesus went, I think about this because a lot of times we can get caught up in some of the snapshots through the Gospels or in the book of Acts or as of who Jesus really was. But as I began to look at this story, that if Jesus came, the divine expression of God comes in human form and he's meeting people. And it brings us to this chapter, John chapter 4. And it says that at the beginning, they are in Judea, and the Pharisees find out. Now, the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, found out that Jesus was and his disciples were baptizing people. Their translation of that was that he was taking from their flock. And these individuals held people at bay with their rules and regulations, whereas Jesus was helping them understand, this is what the Word of God means. And he's teaching them the truth, and they're bought into it, and people are moving away. And when this news starts to come about, Jesus and his disciples decide to leave Judea and go to Galilee. But one of the most powerful passages in this phrase in here that has captivated my attention in the New Living Translation says that they had to go through Samaria. They had to go through Samaria. Now, we may look at that, those of us who travel, and I got a reintroduction to Dallas traffic on Friday. That was tons of fun. Quality time for my wife, Danica, and I as we traveled through and found what our GPS says. If you go this way, it'll take you 13 minutes less. And we said, okay, that's great. We'll take it. Well, it didn't. You know, it took us an hour and a half longer, but it still was a lovely view of rainy Dallas along the thoroughfares. So all the time when we travel, we usually want to take the most efficient route because we want to get there if you are a traveler. But in this passage, you'll see that it says, and they had to go by way or go through Samaria. Now, for those who were like thoroughbred Hebrews, very staunch in their beliefs, some of them would prove the point that they never let the soles of their feet touch Samaria. And they would go all the way around. But there's a deeper reason for this pathway, and we'll find out in just a moment. Because Jesus is never about efficiency. Okay? Efficiency, you can be efficient with your resources, with your time, with the things you have, with your money, but you can't be efficient in relationships. They're too messy. So they're traveling, and they end up stopping in this little town called Sychar, or Sychar, depending upon who's pronouncing it. But it's in an area, in a place that was known for a field that had been given that Jacob the patriarch had given to his son Joseph. This was, as you read the passage, you'll see that that's what it's saying. But here's what's amazing. This is kind of a backstory. Now, I'm a lover of movies, like really good movies. And if you'll note some of the trends in film today, you'll have a film that's created, and then all of a sudden, the next film will be a prequel. I don't know who decided that's what we should do, but that's what they do. But let me give you a prequel snapshot of what happens, because if you turn to Genesis chapter 28, you'll see this moment in the life of Jacob. Now, Jacob was not a sterling character person. He was somewhat of a swindler, and that's a whole other story for a whole other time. But he has swindled his older brother out of the blessing and the birthright, all of his inheritance, more or less. And his brother threatens to kill him. I mean, not a real functional family. So his mom says, you know what? We're going to get you out of town till your brother cools off. So he travels to his uncle Laban's place. And he stops in the desert. And while he's in the desert, it says, as the story goes, he used a rock for him to lay his head on. He starts to sleep, but then he has this vision. And in this vision, there is this staircase that stretches from heaven to earth, and the angels are walking up and down on it. And a powerful message is delivered to Jacob, and it says this. It's the Lord speaking to him. He says, I am the Lord, the God of your grandfather Abraham and the God of your father Isaac. The ground you're lying on belongs to you, and I'm giving it to you and to your descendants. Your descendants will be as numerous as the dust of the earth, and they will spread out over all directions, to the west and to the east, and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the earth will be blessed through your descendants. Okay, now this is what's great. In this moment, in walks Jesus to this little village. The ground that Jacob slept on centuries before, that God said, your descendants are gonna bless all the people of the earth. He walks into a community that has been disdained by the Jewish people because there was a separation in how they thought. And in walks Jesus, the descendant of Jacob, and the blessing is about to occur. And he walks over to a well because, okay, I'm a social science teacher, okay? So geography, those of you who remember ancient civilization started with a well or a water, so freshwater source. Everybody remember that? Hopefully you do, okay? So he sits down. And he's tired because he's 100% human and 100% God. He's thirsty. And his team, all of his guys, go out and they're searching for sandwiches. They're all out looking for supplies because they're also hungry. They've been traveling a long way. And then what you find is the very reason why they had to go to Samaria. And up walks a single lady with what she needs to draw water for her family. It's around about noontime, and it's quiet. And I have an incredible imagination. Like I said, I like watching movies. I also love reading comic books. That's what helped me with my reading skills. And I think about this story as Jesus is just sitting there, and it's quiet. Now, cultural standards at the time, a man did not speak to a woman, and a Hebrew man did not speak to a Samaritan, so you've got a double situation here. It's very quiet, and all you can hear is the sound of this lady as she attaches a rope to her container and drops it down into the well. In just a moment, as it gets really quiet, and they're just minding their own business, Jesus probably just clears his throat. He goes, would you please give me a drink of water? You know, he addresses her with dignity. Would you please give me a drink of water? The light is moving in to extinguish darkness. And she's shocked Because she knows the rules. Why are you, a Jew, speaking to me, a Samaritan woman? And then he says this, if you only knew who was speaking to you and the gift that God has for you, you would be asking me for living water. Now, again, my imagination takes me somewhere. Because as she's sitting there, she's heard these kind of lines before. Who's this charlatan who's got a pickup line that's really bad? And she's looking at him and she sizes him up and says, okay, sailor, I'll play your game. Now, how can you give me this water? You don't have a bucket, you don't have a rope, and how could what water you would give me would be greater than what our ancestor Jacob had for feeding his people, for drinking water for his people and their animals? You know, in this moment, and I just imagine how the dialogue would go. But Jesus looks at her, and here's the thing. The divine expression of God, the truth, sitting side by side with a woman whose life he already knows, she's lived a life of great pain, suffered. But yet she's resilient and she's doing her assignment. And Jesus responds to her and says, listen, anyone who drinks of this water is going to be thirsty again. But if you will take in this water, the water I have to give to you, it will become like a fresh spring that will bubble up from inside. You'll never be thirsty. It will provide for you for all eternity. You know, in this moment, and this is what's amazing, is that as the light comes in to extinguish the darkness, and here's what is so amazing to me as I look at what Christ does for each one of us. That in this moment where Jesus is reaching to her with the truth and love, barriers begin to break down. And she looks into his eyes and she sees the eyes of hope. The eyes of, could there be a better way? And she responds to him in a voice of desperation, and she says, please, please give me this water so I will never have to come back here again. I will never have to come back here. And Jesus asks her this question. He says, go get your husband. Well, I don't have a husband. He says, you have spoken the truth. You've had five husbands, and the one you're living with now isn't even your husband. You've truly told the truth. You know what this is in this moment? This is actually a confession. It's not an apology. She's been able to share the truth with Jesus, and in that moment, she has this time where there's nothing between the two of them. Well, oftentimes we think in terms of, well, I'm going to need to clean a few things up before I meet with Jesus, but when you really meet with him, he sees through everything. And in that time, as she's speaking to him, there's no barrier between the two of them, and light has come in, not to burn things up, but to unite the God of the universe who loves her dearly with this truth in love. It's amazing when you see it. But to her in that moment, she's like, okay, I just met you and you've just outed me. And she says, well, apparently you are a prophet. So why is it that you worship, the Jews worship over here in Jerusalem? You say that's where we should be, but we worship on this mountain. What's Help me understand that. And you know what's amazing in this thing is that Jesus will not let us change the subject. He always, no matter if we try to reroute, he brings us back to him. And so in this story, I love it because as she's talking to him, and as he says, listen, there's going to come a time when it doesn't matter where you worship. And he explains it. He says, you know, we look at it like this. We try to look at life, and let me just give you a little backstory on this woman from what I can see in her life. Jesus has exposed what's happening, the truth or the facts in her life. We don't know what has transpired. Five husbands, did they all die? Was there a divorce? We do know that culturally speaking, during that time, a woman didn't have the power to make a decision about what was going to happen with her future. And at the very end in her life, she was stuck in a place where she was serving someone, or maybe in a home, where no one was really committed to her. And she was just living life from day to day. It was survival. It was rejection. And what a dark time for someone. But she comes back to him with these questions about worship. And he says, and he's listening to her, but then he comes back and he says, listen, dear woman. And I love that, a term of endearment. The time is coming when it won't matter whether you worship the Father on this mountain or in Jerusalem. But the time is coming, indeed it is here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And the Father is looking for those who will worship him in that way. For God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. That's what he's looking for. It doesn't matter where you go. But it matters who you are. And wherever you stand with God. And this is, he's unveiling this to her. And as the light begins to expose this, she's listening to him. And she says, you know, she's taking it in. And she says, look, I know the Messiah, the one they call the Christ. I know when he comes, he'll straighten this all out. He'll explain it to us, how this is supposed to work. And right at that moment, Jesus leans in. Just to be honest with you, I don't know what it's like to really stare into the eyes of Christ like those people in the first century could. You think about every person who was touched by the hand of Jesus, and it wasn't a frivolous touch. It wasn't just like, and he's touching people. He made eye contact with people at their deepest point of need. And we see that in those conversations, those deep conversations that he had with individuals. So I try to imagine what that must have been like as they're sitting side by side and they're just talking about life and worship and existence and survival and how he wants to move her to a level of thriving. A nameless woman that we will never know who she is, and she suffers greatly, and he's bringing her to a point where she moves from just getting water for survival to water, spiritual water that will allow her to thrive, to move her from this just existing day to day to someone who has a dynamic impact on her community. And as they're sitting there, Jesus leans in and they make eye contact. And what that must be like to stare into the eyes of the Savior. And he looks into her eyes and he says, I am the Messiah. I am the Messiah. And in that moment, it clicks. And right about that time, his team shows up with all the supplies and they're watching all this play out, and they're wondering, why is he talking to the Samaritan woman? Well, she sprints off into the village and begins to tell the people, all of her neighbors, all these people that maybe she never thought they didn't want to be seen with her, or she didn't want to be seen with them, but all of a sudden she's telling all these people and influencing them, you must meet this. He told me everything about myself. Could he be this Messiah? In the meantime, his team shows up and they're like, you've got to be hungry. I mean, we've been walking a long time. But Jesus says something that was so powerful to me, is that he says, look, my nourishment is not about food. My nourishment is doing what God has called me to do. It's finishing his work. And when you think about this, take it all the way back to the very first chapter of John. As his only responsibility was to reach people, show them this is what God's will is. This is my will is to bring, God's will is to bring people back into him, to bring light so that there'll be more children that will follow God. They'll come to know salvation. And so he's fulfilled in that moment. And as they're talking, this woman goes in and the villagers come out and they begin to meet with Jesus and they beg him to stay. And I love this. Here they are in a place that was deemed unholy, if you will, by their people. But the scriptures say that they stayed for 2 more days. And my favorite part in the passage is at the very end where it says, many Samaritans from the village believed in Jesus because of what the woman had said. That he said, he told me everything I did. And then they came to see him and they begged him to stay in their village. So he stayed for 2 more days, long enough for many more to hear the message and believe. Then they said to the woman, now we believe, not just because of what you told us, because we have heard him ourselves and we know he is the Savior of the world. How powerful that is when you think about they had to go to Samaria to see one person. And we see one life changed who influences an entire community. Now, what's the application to this story? Well, the first thing I would say is that we're all the woman at the well. Nobody's exempt from it. Every single one of us have something at times that holds us hostage. And oftentimes, it may be just the fact that we are living on a level of survival, just from day to day. I believe this with all my heart, that we have an enemy of our soul who would love to have each one of us just existing. You know, as you look in the book of Exodus and you see the children of Israel who were finally set free and they had so much trouble trusting in God. The reason why that he only fed them one day at a time was to get them to believe him. He had to retrain their thinking. And oftentimes we get caught in worrying about the things that we cannot control for. And I believe as we look at this story and we see this woman who is just surviving. And what the Lord wants for each one of us is that we will align in our trust in him, in the light that will not be extinguished by the darkness. But we align with him and that living water that he promises, that's for all of us. That for each one of us, that can happen. And so as we look at that, the next thing is this, that Jesus will travel by whatever means necessary to get to you. He's not operating in efficiencies. He's working in effectiveness. And each person that was touched by Christ, he reached to them. And he knew where they were. And so he will work for you to move you from surviving to thriving. In a level that you could never imagine. The third thing I want you to remember is that he will bring you to truthful conversations. It's really fascinating when you see this story that as he begins to speak to this woman, he asks her a question. And she speaks honestly to him about her current status. But he also goes a little bit deeper. You know, Jesus doesn't work on surface conversations. You know how it goes when you ask someone, hey, how are you doing? They say, good. Doing great. But when you may know, okay, there's probably something more going on. And Jesus doesn't just work on one-word responses. And since he already knows what's going on in our lives, it's really important that we have those times of confession to him and say, you know what? I am struggling with this, or I have an issue with this, or I have an issue with that person, or I'm struggling with fear, I am afraid, or I've got these things. And it's not just about that, but also you can confess, you know what, Lord, yesterday was a great day. Yesterday, I stuck the landing on X, or I did this, and I'm grateful because I know it was you who made it happen. But those truthful conversations with Jesus, he will always bring you back to bringing you to a point where you are worshiping in spirit and in truth, that everything we put our hand to is an opportunity for worship. I don't care if you are an accountant working with major firms or if you're serving up burgers at the In-N-Out. That's worship. Now, those of you who may work in the food industry may question that, but I'm just telling you, I have seen it happen. But whatever it is that we put our hand to, that the Lord can work through us in this crazy, amazing way, that his living water will bubble through us, and it is something that just keeps regenerating. And in the end, the final thing I just want you to know is this. If we put our lives in the hands of the Lord, and I'm just telling you, I'm a testimony of this. By trusting the Lord, that he will put you in a place where your influence on the people around you will be more than you could possibly imagine. I was, as I've watched this happen in my own life, I was very fortunate being raised by godly people. I never questioned my parents, the stability of my parents' marriage. They were married for 63 years. I was very fortunate to be raised by people who trusted the Lord. I was very fortunate to be raised by people who suffered the loss of children, my older brother and sister. Early in their marriage and in ministry, they buried two children. So they understood suffering. But there was never a moment where I ever saw them even lean against following the Lord. So I'm a fortunate son. But the one thing is this, that as I began to learn and grow in my walk, it was my walk that I was responsible for. And whatever I choose to do, as I have learned to do my best, but realize that my best efforts are an act of worship. Your best efforts for whatever it is that you do, whatever you attend to, that's worship. And what happens is you never even know what impact that's going to make on not just the people in earshot, but the ripple effect beyond that. So this woman in John chapter 4 is immortalized because she was in the right place at the right time, but because the Lord came to see her, he had to go see her, and he has to go see each one of us. And if we'll open our hearts every day, he will greet us, he will take us, he will fill each one of us with that living water that he promised to her. And just watch what happens when you do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for this great body of believers. I am so fortunate to be here and to have experienced time in your presence, as they are every week. Lord, your word to us, every word of it, every page is so powerful, and if we read it enough, we see that you are constantly pursuing us, that your purpose is to reach each one. So today, as we call on you, as we take time just to meditate on your word and to spend time in worship as we sing and as we lift our hands to you, I pray that everyone in this room would have that encounter where we accept that living water that you have for each one of us to set us free from the bondage that we may have. That you will strengthen us to trust in you, that our lives truly will be worshiping you in spirit and in truth. So, Lord, I just pray that your word will sink deep into the tablets of our hearts. Let us walk with you this day in trusting you, that whatever it is that we do with our hands and our feet, our minds, our hearts, our words, will bring honor to you and draw people to you, to the same well that we drink of. We ask these things in Christ's name.